They shall eat, and there shall be left over.
I urge you to live in a manner worthy of the call you have received.
The first thing that St. Paul mentions, and it's very often a misunderstood virtue, is humility. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome all of you here on this very lovely Saturday night, especially those who may be visiting us. Tonight and for the next 3 weekends, we hear Jesus talk about bread, about hunger and fulfillment, about becoming bread for the world. This evening's gospel, Jesus feeds 5,000 loaves and fishes. There's more than enough for everyone. So let us begin our prayer this evening, remembering that there is more than enough food, goods, time, and even energy for whatever we need.
Lord Jesus, you nourish us with your word. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you feed us with your own body. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you call us to proclaim your word and share our bread with others. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, you open wide your hand, giving us food in due season. Out of your never-failing abundance, satisfy the hungers of body and soul, and lead all peoples of the earth to the feast of the world to come. We make our prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A proclamation from the second book of Kings. A man came from Baalshea and bring to Elijah, the man of God, 20 barley loaves made from the first fruits and fresh grain in the ear. Elijah said, "Give it to the people to eat." But his servant objected, "How can I set this before 100 people?" Elijah insisted, "Give it to the people to eat. For thus says the Lord, they shall eat, and there shall be left over." And when they had eaten, there was some left over, as the Lord had said. The word of the Lord.
A proclamation from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, I, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, one body and one Spirit, as you were also called to the one hope of your call, One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The word of the Lord.
The Lord is with you.
And with your spirit.
A proclamation of the Holy Gospel according to the tradition of John.
Glory to the Lord.
Jesus went across the Sea of Galilee. A large crowd followed him because they saw the signs he was performing on the sick. And Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. The Jewish feast of Passover was near. When Jesus raised his eyes and saw the large crowd that was coming to him, he said to Philip, "Where can we buy enough food for them to eat?" He said this to test Philip, because he himself knew what he was going to do. Now Philip answered him, 200 days' wages worth of food would not be enough for each of them just to have a little. Now one of his disciples, Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, said to him, "There's a boy here, and he has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good are those for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people recline." Now there was a great deal of grass in that place. So they reclined, about 5,000 in number. Jesus took the loaves, and he gave thanks, and he distributed them to those who were reclining, and also as much of the fish as they wanted. And when they had had their fill, he said to his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing will be wasted." So they collected them and filled 12 wicker baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves that had been more than enough for them to eat. When the people saw this sign that he had done, they said, this is truly the prophet, the one who is to come into the world." Since Jesus knew that they were going to come and carry him off to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain alone. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
More than a week now has transpired since the awful events in Colorado, Antioch. Aurora, rather. And it's during this week, of course, with great sadness in the burial of the victims, 12 of them, who suffered death as a result. It's human for us to quickly forget about these things. Now, with the beginning of the Olympics and all the excitement that goes with it, our attention is focused on that, which is understandable and natural. But I think we can still go back for purposes of reflection, ask a few questions. I did that this week. I listened to a number of commentaries from the news reporters and TV analysts, and I read some of the editorials saying, how can one make sense out of a tragedy as great as this? And the only thing I could really come to was the notion that it's insanity. That's the only thing that can explain it. It is insanity. And there's also a kind of irony here, because we're talking about a young man now, a very brilliant young man, who earlier on was dedicating himself to help people medically, to get into the field of medicine, and more recently into nuclear research, which would help to understand some of the problems with the human brain and heal people that way. And to have that goal, that desire, that purpose in life, and suddenly to turn everything around and do the very opposite thing for someone as brilliant as he was or is very difficult to understand. And as you say, there is a kind of irony in this. And so this evening I would ask that we would continue to pray for those who've died, for their families. Let's also remember those who are injured. We know that some of them are seriously injured. And let's at least continue to keep them in our prayers. I'm sure it would mean a lot to them to know that people this far away from Colorado are praying for them. And we have some Wisconsin connections, as you know. It's a reminder to all of us that we live in a very violent society. We'd like not to think of our society as violent, but it is. It seems as if a day can't pass by when we don't hear about, read about, or see on TV another homicide within our own community. Maybe not an actual homicide, but an attempted homicide. Day after day after day. And Milwaukee is no exception. Other cities are experiencing the very same thing. You say, well, it's summer, it's hot, and people are outside and they get angry. You can understand all of those things. But it doesn't excuse the fact that we are a violent society. There are other forms of violence besides homicide, of course. We think of domestic violence. Many times we don't hear about it or read about it, but it goes on right within our own homes, sometimes simply verbally, but nevertheless it's a form of violence. What we see on TV so often is that way, or our movies are that way. So often the whole theme is getting even with, revenge. We have to somehow get back at that person or those people who have done this awful thing. And then, of course, this thing we call road rage. So there's all forms of it. It's not simply homicide. I'm always intrigued with the fact, as we look at the Ten Commandments, we come to commandment number 5, which says, thou shalt not kill. And then we look at some of the subsets or other things that flow from that, and the very first thing that flows from the 5th commandment is, thou shalt not be angry with your neighbor. And you see, that really makes a lot of sense, because so much of what we're talking about flows from anger. It's that very powerful emotion, which isn't always bad, by the way. Our Lord was angry for the right reasons and in ways that will not hurt other people or ourselves. It's perfectly all right. But we're talking about a destructive anger that can lead to the terrible things I've just mentioned. It's so closely connected to that 5th commandment. St. Paul today, in the second reading, gives us what I think would be a list of virtues for the Christian life. Not only that, I'd go on to say ways of dealing with the violence in our society. He doesn't say everything, but he lifts up 3 things. And I'd like to take a moment, if you want to call them virtues, fine, those 3 virtues that he mentions and kind of just revolve on them a bit, and we might carry them with us for further reflection. By the way, when you talk about virtue, it isn't just simply following a rule. It's more than that. It's a commitment to a way of life. As Jesus, our Good Shepherd, has laid out that life for us, and we are committed to following him, living out that life, this is what we mean by living a righteous or virtuous life. Even when it's difficult, we hold fast to that commitment. The first thing that St. Paul mentions, and it's very often a misunderstood virtue, is humility. In fact, they say that in the time of the ancient Greeks, they didn't even have the word in their vocabulary, because the thought of it means somehow we have to cower before someone else, that we have to put ourselves down and make ourselves off to be less than we really are, to deny any strengths or virtues or values, personal values, and that isn't humility at all. Humility, at least in St. Paul's understanding, the Christian understanding, is honesty. Honesty, first of all, with ourselves, where we try to get to know ourselves better all the time. Honesty with others, so we're transparent and they get to know us as we really are. And above all, honesty with God. That in a certain sense, there's nothing to hide. We are who we are, with our strengths, with our weaknesses, with goodness and blind spots, we are who we are. And so, it's a self-honesty that also recognizes our total dependence upon God. We can't go it alone. We need God at every instance in our lives. So this honesty, St. Paul says, is so important. Call it that, call it humility. The second thing he mentions is gentleness, and another word for that may be thoughtfulness. Consideration of others. It's a communal or community spirit that goes against selfish individualism. And you've heard me say this before, there is so much of that within our culture, which is closely allied with violence, because number one comes first. I'm number one, and I may consider you somewhere down the line, as long as I'm number one. This week in the Catholic Herald, some of you I'm sure received that, it's a wonderful article by Bishop Skelba on this very subject. It's entitled, Distorted Individualism, a Disease of the Human Spirit. And he lists all kinds of instances of that. It's not just a generalization, but what's so good about the article, he gives some very important insights into ways we find that going on within our society, within our own homes, within our lives, day after day after day. But he doesn't stop there. He goes on to what would be antidotes to this individualism, this distorted individualism. And the one thing we can do, in fact, we're doing right now, is we are celebrating a community prayer. We're not here with our own prayers, our own devotions. We're here to celebrate, to sing, to pray, to receive the Eucharist that Christ is talking about and will be the next several Sundays in the Gospel, this sacrament of unity, communion. And so we begin to recognize what it is we're doing. Those of us who are older may recall how we used to do it. When it was in a foreign language, the priest had his back to the people, and everyone came here with her or his own devotion, rosary, prayer book devotions, all of which are good, by the way, and we should be praying them, but not now. This is a community prayer. And this is one of the most powerful ways we can deal with sinful individualism, because if we really are into what's going on and we listen to God's word, which so often brings us back to this notion of the common good and not simply what's good for me, is what it's all about. And so we have, first of all, this honesty or humility. We have thoughtfulness or gentleness. And finally, and this is a tough one, Paul mentions patience. Courtesy toward others, even those who try our patience, even those who are difficult to work with or live with, patience with them as well. And I always say, think of how patient God is with us in forgiving us time and time and time again. God's patience with us. And we need to exhibit, show that patience with one another, especially for the sake of our young people. This is how they learn to be patient people by seeing us as being patient with them and with others. Humility or honesty, gentleness or thoughtfulness, patience, courtesy toward others. These, you might say, are the social virtues that go against so much of the violence and so much of the sinful or distorted individualism in our society. And I guess rather than wring our hands and say, well, what can we do about it? Paul says, these are the things we can do about it, very simply, to practice these virtues day in and day out. They are the ones that will overcome violence and further the well-being of our society, looking out for the good of each other, even for persons whom we do not know that well. Please join us now as a community in professing our faith. I believe in one God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God. My friends, we believe in God's care for us and God's power to provide for what we need. It's with that in mind, then, that we now offer these prayers.
Our response this afternoon is, feed us, O Lord. For the hungry of every nation, for those who struggle to find enough food for their children, for those who are starving, for those who will die today for lack of food, we pray. Feed us, O Lord. For those whose hungers are self-destructive, those who struggle with the addiction to alcohol or drugs, food, sex, work, material goods, or power. For all those struggling with habits of sin, we pray. Feed us, O Lord. For those who hunger for the Eucharist, for those faithful members of our community who are not Catholic, but who accompany their families to worship, for those waiting for annulments, for all those who long for the Eucharist. We pray, feed us, O Lord. For our military personnel and our Peace Corps and Red Cross volunteers who are scattered around the world, may they experience the prayers of a nation as they work for peace for all people. We pray.
Feed us, O Lord.
For rain for our farmers and gardeners, for all who provide food for others, we pray.
Feed us, O Lord.
For those who are sick, for those who struggle with chronic pain or illness, for those who are struggling to lose weight, for those living with the complications of obesity, diabetes, or arthritis. We pray, feed us,
O Lord.
We remember those who are signed in our book of life, and for all those who mourn the loss of someone dear, and especially tonight for Terry Boho and Ralph Eberly, for whom this Eucharist is offered, we pray.
And for the victims of violence, and particularly those who experienced it last week in Colorado, for those who have died, that they may be granted eternal rest, for those who are wounded, that they may be healed, we pray to the Lord. Graciously, God, you provide for us abundantly. Help us to live as a people created in your image and to share our blessings with others. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. And on page 29, come and follow me.
Be my heart for the world.
Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept your sacrifice for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and for all God's holy church.
Lord, accept these offerings which we have drawn from your bountiful goodness, that by the working of your grace, these sacred mysteries may sanctify our lives on earth and lead us to the joys of life eternal. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin. Fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, and so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Benedict our Pope, Jerome our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
through him and with him and in him. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power,
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And
let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace be with you. Thank you. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord,
this time we call forth our ministers to take Eucharist to the homebound. We ask you to go forth to our members who cannot be with us today because of illness and take the word and the body of Christ to them. And we send you forth in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We have shared, O Lord, in this sacrament, which is the lasting memorial of your Son's passion. Grant, we pray, that this gift of his surpassing love may bring us closer to our salvation. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
After the announcements this evening, we're going to hear a little bit about one of the important parish activities here, and that is the work of the St. Vincent de Paul Conference. So we invite you to please be seated.
Good afternoon. The collection for Operation Backpack is starting up. The bin is in the gathering area. Please see the bulletin for more information. Don't forget to sign up for the St. James Golf outing on Saturday, August 11th. Registration forms are available in the gathering area and the parish office. Please check the bulletin for the upcoming art environment meetings. There will be a blood drive here at St. James on Monday, July 30th, in the community center between 2 and 7 o'clock p.m. Please see last week's bulletin to call or email for an appointment. And see the bulletin and website for more information about activities and events in the parish. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Zoltan Esses. I am president of the St. Vincent de Paul Conference here at St. James. I want to talk a few minutes about our organization. St. Vincent de Paul is organized for the spiritual growth of its members. We accomplish this through two main mechanisms. One is spiritual reflection, and the other is service to the poor. At each of our twice monthly meetings, we start or open and close our meetings with prayer. And in addition, we set aside time for spiritual reflection. This reflection is typically a reading of Scripture. After that, we reflect on how we measure up to the Lord's calling. Oftentimes, we can say that we measure up quite well, which is a good positive reinforcer, builds our self-esteem. At other times, we recognize we can do more. And that also motivates us and energizes us to be more effective with our service to the poor. Our service to the poor is for situations where there's a temporary emergency need. Typically, that will be a utility shutoff or an eviction notice. There are other situations, but by and large, those are the two main ones. We help the poor by doing a home visit. This personal interaction is really important in that it gives the people that we help the satisfaction of knowing that someone really does care. It also validates that they're not an exception, they're not deadbeats or anything like that. At these home visits, we'll respectfully listen to what they have to say. ask some questions, perhaps probing for opportunities in their budget, or if they've accessed all the public and private resources they have available. Once we're done with that, we'll make calls to the utility or the landlord, as the case may be, for the purpose of verifying what they have to say, and also for working out plans, potentially defer payment, set up a budget. We're much more successful with the utility than landlords, but we try with each one. After that, we meet, and the group as a whole will contribute their input, and through that, hopefully the collective wisdom will give us the best answer as far as helping these people. We also collaborate with Sussex Outreach Services, SOS, and through our combined resources, we're more effective in helping the poor. It also helps to give us some background information on the people we're trying to help. Since St. Vincent de Paul was reconstituted in 2006, we've fielded over 620 calls for help from the St. James Parish area. We've paid out over $60,000 in some forms of assistance. That assistance would not be possible without the great generosity of the St. James community. We don't get any government funding. All of our money comes through St. James, either through collection or direct donations. Other way, so we're thankful for your generosity and hope that that continues. There are other ways you can help us. We currently have a clothing drive going, and we can use any kind of clothing. Obviously, brand new would be best. We could also use lightly used. And what about your torn t-shirt with its paint stains and that body odor that your Febreze infused tie just can't seem to get rid of? Yes, we want that too. What our stores will do is they'll sort out the clothing, and what's in good shape will go on the racks for sale to the public, and what's not in good shape we'll sell in bulk to some manufacturers who will pay us good money for it. The stores make good money out of both types of sales. The other way you can help is through volunteering. If this seems to be calling for you, please join us. If you're not certain, come to a couple of our meetings. If you like what you see, join us. If not, well, at least you gave us a shot. The work is very rewarding. Just to see the reaction of the people, you know, when they find out they're going to be helped. Just recently, we assisted a few elderly couples with electric utility, you know, shut off, threatened. And to see the relief on their face that they won't have to face these 100-degree days without AC or have their food spoil in their refrigerator is just great. To me, it's more rewarding just seeing that tension and stress leave their face. That's more rewarding than hearing the thank yous and the God bless yous. In other cases, we hear back later. We had a single mother who wrote to us saying that putting a stop to an eviction notice helped keep stability in her life, where she was able to continue with her education. She got her nursing degree and is unlikely to need our assistance, you know, anytime. Other people who've received our help have joined ministries here, St. Vincent de Paul, and others as well. So it's nice to see that they're giving back. So thank you once again. Your generosity has been awesome. If you want to help, either through donations and or volunteers, we'll have a table out back in the gathering area, and we'd be happy to talk to you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Betty Rooney, and a member of our Health Ministry Committee. And I have the privilege to speak about a wonderful person, our retiring parish nurse, Ann Sardegna. After 8.5 years of impassioned ministry to our parish family, Ann has determined that it is time to retire. Ann has been and is a wonderful healer, attending to our physical as well as our spiritual needs. She has visited many of us when we were homebound, bringing us Eucharist, and arranging for and participating in the Sacrament of the Sick, our blood pressure screening program, and coordinating meals for the ill and the homebound. As an educated nurse professional, she has written many articles to help us with health issues and has coordinated a number of health education programs within our parish and our cluster. Many of us in the pews have been touched by the compassion and caring of this wonderful woman. We wish Anne the very best as she retires and hope you will take a moment after today's celebration to do the same. Please join us for some cake and refreshments in the gathering space. And Anne, I know you're here. If you would please stand so as a community we can show our appreciation.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Our Mass has ended. Let us go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another. Thanks be to God.
And as we go forth this evening, let us all sing together Companions on the Journey, found on page 32.